saying second talk. It wouldn't heavily depend on the first talk, but it will take some ideas out of it. This will be given by Prognadipto Majumder from the second year. He has told me that his interests are so varied that it includes everything except CS. So, no, physics. He's converted now.
Here's the thing, to talk about open set and closed set. Do you want to repeat the definition? Yeah, open set is that. Open set. Open set. You take a polynomial. And I'm just wanting to take a neighborhood. There will be some neighborhood which completely becomes the set E. Open set G. Now, let's divide the notation for this neighborhood. I'm writing B, R, X. This is the open ball at X with radius R. The set of all y belongs to E of the set such that distance of x, y strictly less than R. I will use a lot of time. And now, how do you define closed set? Now, closed set is that the limit, all the limit points of the set lie in that set. Now, but what is the limit point? Take a set E. Now, take a point x in it. No. Take a point y. We don't know whether it lies in E or not.
The problem is that the writing is too small.
Yeah.
The
writing is very
sensitive. Make
it
like E. Now, there is a point Y. Take any neighborhood around you. This is radius R. Any neighborhood. For all rows of R. For all rows of R, we get at least one point in this region which belongs to E. So, now how about to get the idea? You take all these exponents. Reduce the R in number of times, you get a sequence of convergence to Y. That's the main idea. So we call Y limit point of E. If all the limit points lie in the set, that's the closed set. Now, this, you can open this 0, 1. You take 1 by N. So 1 by N, this belongs to this set, and this convergence is 0. So 0 does not lie in the set. So this is not closed. Now it's pretty evident to prove that the open sets and closed sets are complementary. Complement of open sets closed and vice versa. So that's it. Now another important concept we need is that compact set. This is a very important concept. How do you define compact sets? First, you define open compact. You take open sets, okay. Go on. In the arbitrary union of open sets, I belong to some index set. Maybe the answer is any arbitrary union of open sets is open. Is that obvious? Yeah. You take a point x, it has some neighborhood that completely belongs to some OI, and that belongs to the whole A. So, it's okay. Now, the open common. Open common set is the open set, or rather, collection of open sets that covers the entire set. Covers means the line, the set is W, and W is a subset of the union of open sets. Now, what is a compact set? A compact set is that you take any open cover that must have finite subcover. Finite, not just number. And this is a very strong property. Now we can say, we prove actually, in real numbers, compact is the same as closed and bounded. Closed and bounded. In R. You can prove this in some way. We get into later of time, we can prove this up. Okay, we'll do it later. It's not that important. Actually, it's not going to happen. Now, another property in real numbers. Have you heard about the Bolzano Weirstrass theorem?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just let me take it from convenience. Every bound close and every bounded sequence in real numbers has a convergent subsequence. Now, how do we generalize? How do we relate this to compact sets? As it turns out, Bolzano Weirstrass property. Bolzano Weirstrass property. As it turns out, in any metric space, compact if and only if it satisfies the Bolzano Weirstrass property. We can do the general version of Bolzano Weirstrass theorem later if you have time. And I guess we will have time.
Can you say what theorem?
Bolzano Weirstrass theorem. In any matrix case, Bolzano Weirstrass property is not a theorem right now. You have a matrix that x, d. We call that this has this Bolzano Weirstrass property if every sequence x and belongs to x has a convergent subsequence. Convergent subsequence x in y. Yeah. This belongs to this. If for every sequence this holds, we call this that yeah. This matrix space has the Bolzano Weirstrass property. Now in real numbers, we have the Bolzano Weirstrass property if and only if it is closed and bounded. Closed and bounded. So this is the same as compact to real numbers. Now in the terms of any matrix space, compact case and Bolzano Weirstrass property. Now to the same thing. Now we have another concept for the later part of the talk. You keep this in mind. This is going to be the most important idea of our talk. And we are trying to see how this property holds in a different matrix space, the space of functions. There we will call it the Arzelà-Ascoli theorem. It's similar. It's kind of generalization of this idea. Now, what will be the basis? Basis. S and E is built in A. If every point of E either belongs to E, either this belongs to E, or limit point of this. That means that you have a given space x. You can approximate it by points of E as close as possible. You have a set of rational real numbers, real and rational numbers. Rational numbers is Q is dense enough. Take a real number, either a rational number, or it can be approximated by a sequence of rational numbers converging to that property. We can prove it by the necessary inverse property, and this is for any basis. Now we have an interesting property. Why do we care so much about compact space? As we see, this compact space has nice properties. This compact space is open box. These two sets, these two classes of sets, they turn out to be very important in matrix spaces, generally very complex. Now, you, as you see, this x, this will be unknowable. And as you know, it's always easier to want to count those stuff. Counting stuff, you can just, there's a lot of things. And sometimes you can index like that. It's not that easy. There's an interesting theorem. Every first, let me call separable. This doesn't turn. Don't worry about the word separable, why separable. Separable. X, D is separable matrix space. If it has a countable
finite subcover.
That's a very strong property. If you open one, it's not going to subcover. It won't say anything about the open property. It's taking a compact dimension of scale in the dimension of field. It is compact. Okay. Very simple. Now, you take what every x belongs to. Yeah. First, take an n. Okay.
Write a bit bigger. Bit bigger.
Yeah. N, a natural number. For every point x belongs to this k, you take this ball. B of 1 by f, comma x. This is open, right? And union of all this over x. Thank you. because shortly we are going to move to the entire different topic and we will come back to the later there is also. Any questions? Yeah. Complex. Complex is that any open cover.
Does this even exist? If it exists, can we take it and use it for the same idea?
limit double limit. And it turns out it's wrong. Let's say 90 example.
Two sequences are going simultaneously.
Yeah, what?
Two sequences are going simultaneously.
There are two different sequences. This latent convergence is extreme convergence to some extreme alone. Can we say that this is a convergence or something like that? Or if a limit exists, or we can get into the
right hand side is just absolute.
It's the same thing, right?
Huh.
number one, but
yeah, here is R, so we can just say absolute value. Instead of R, if you say for y over d, d dash, some other matrix space, does it take a distance? Nothing will change. But yeah, let's focus on this absolute value. Now, everyone knows what supremum is?
Yes.
So, this is positive. That's the value. And this is 0 if and only if this 0 is 0. So, this is a positive base value. That's why the first two conditions are matrices. And the primary inequality. F minus G, F and G.
Yeah.
of x in the complex value continuous.
Because this is convergence, but this is not in the space. The point zero doesn't exist in some sense.
because this doesn't converge with this and divergence. Counterintuitive. So this converges the space of functions to a complement. So what do you want now actually? You want a characterization of this compact. How do we define continuity? If the space is continuity. for all y belongs to 6 epsilon greater than 0. Then there is delta such that for all y belongs to 1 log delta around this.
Compass.
is a family of functions. This f is, f is compact, economical, it is closed, bounded, and equicontinuous. Now you see here, F is a compact set. Compactness in this way. This compactness implies it's closed, bounded, and equicontinuous. So every compact set is closed. We can prove that. It's a pretty easy effect, which I don't want to prove right now. If you have time, we can prove later. Boundedness just follows on the definition. They count on the subcover. Yeah, there is minor number of points. And everything is at some inside distance from each of these points. So bounded is obvious. So what we just need to prove is equicontinuous. So let's prove it. This direction is kind of easier. In the opposite direction, we can just assume, we don't need to assume this stronger notion of uniformly boundedness. We can just work with point one. That's the main function of Arzelà-Ascoli. Otherwise, we could just say that this is just a continuous. And this point wise convergence boundedness implies uniform boundedness, actually. Suppose it is not equal continuous, then what can we say? There exist two sequences. X and Y such that and there exists a sequence of functions F n such that this F distance of X n comma Y n less than 1 by U but F n of X n minus F n of Y n this is greater than some epsilon. This is the nature of the statement, not equicontinuous. If it is equicontinuous for all, then it is okay. This Fn, can this have an equicontinuous subsequent?
No.
Because, yeah, if take any subsequent, take the corresponding x and y. Then take a subsequent of the x, not the x and y. So, this cannot have an equicontinuous subsequent. Now we want, but we want any. This implies that X is a compact. Why? Because any uniformly convergent subsequence, any uniformly convergent sequence of functions, that should be equicontinuous. Yeah. This F of N, this we want to be. Convergent. This convergent to something. And we have a property that every uniformly continuous sequence of functions in this space, this must be equicontinuous. Yeah, I'm going to prove that shortly. But right now, consider this fact. If it is equicontinuous, that's the contradiction. So this is just the contradiction. So we have proved nothing actually. We have proved that fact. Every uniformly continuous sequence of functions is equicontinuous. So, let's try to prove that. Just wait a minute. Basically, we are taking the open walls around each of these points, okay? Any uniformly continuous state is equicontinuous. So take a compact set and all that, take the open Bolzano each of these points. Now from there take the open forward. And after that take the finite subforward. Taking this finite subforward gives you finitely many points. From there, this finitely many points you get an epsilon distance and back you can conclude equicontinuity. If you get more time, you prove that later. Now we have to prove the opposite direction. That if it is equicontinuous, then we have equicompact. And compact means that it has a the subsequence. Bolzano Weirstrass property that every sequence has a convergent subsequence. Now you will be wondering why do we need separable? Why do we need separable? Now this is a lemma. What is the one that you do? Fn one is bounded. Bounded on a set. On a set. So this Fn has a subsequence that converges for every x belongs to this E. Now how do you prove this? Okay, this is the most important thing. Countable. Countable means the point of E you can write as xi I x1, x2, enumerate. What is the definition of countable? We have bijection from this set to rational numbers and vice versa. So let's do that. This is a set. Let's write if 1, x 1. If 1, if 2, x 1. Go on. This is just a sequence of real numbers. Isn't it? So apply the normal Bolzano Weirstrass theorem. This has a convergence subsequence. Write this as if 1 comma I. So like S1 is S11, S12, S13, S13. Looking like an infinite matrix. It will look like an infinite matrix, not me. But it is true. This is another sequence of functions. Okay. What will you do in S2? Follow this definition. F11 x2 F12 x2. On this you have put the value of x2. This is the sequence of real numbers. My Bolzano Weirstrass is has a convergent subsequence. Just call it F21 x1 F22 x2. Okay, we are not writing x2 here. F21 x1 F22. Now I guess you can vaguely have the idea of what I am going to do. Do the same thing with Sn. Now notice the following things. S of n plus 1 is a subsequence of S of n. Obvious, that's how we define it. Take any two points here. This and this. Coming here. Somewhere here. This can come to the left, but then go to the right. We are not adding anything new. And the order is preserved. If these two are both are coming here, the left one becomes remains left and the right one remains left. So from this observation, S3, your right one is S31, S32, S33. Now the beautiful idea of diagonalization. Take this. I'm running this, okay. Running this down. What's so special about this F11, F22? Does this solve the problem? Think. This, S1, S1 of X1 converges. S2 of X2 converges. SN of if you convergence. Now convergence is a property of the tail. You don't see, you don't care what happens in the beginning. After a certain period of time, you get the tail and the tail converges, so the sequence converges. Take a name. FLN is lies here. So from here, the rest of the sequence converges. For all XN. And all XN have enumerated in this set because it's sound. And take it. And for any I less than it, this part obviously converges because I is less than it. And if n plus 1, n plus k, from n plus k, this already lies in the SN. Whatever is to the right of FN, this lies in SN. Subset of SN. So for all XN is converges. So this is a sequence that converges for all X belongs to this category. Okay.
Why can't we take the vertical thing like F1 and F2?
Vertical thing.
Just wait.
We are talking about convergence, bro. First things you can never ensure convergence. We can ensure that this goes sufficiently large. But for the beginning, so let's say this remains the same. Suppose this F1 is the same as F2 or the same as F3 one. Nothing can happen. The things can move to the left but never to the right. I told you. So these two can never be the same. That's why we use the idea. And the if it was they will preserve the order will be preserved in the below. So that. If LN from N to the tail converges, that's why we use that second idea. So we got a sequence of functions that converges when E is counting. Now we talked about separable metric space, and in this separable metric space, the idea concept is you are approximating it by some countable set. We first prove this for countable. Now we will approximate that by a countable set, and then we will work it out. Ask you, this is okay. Take one and wait for one. So the main statement of the Arzelà-Ascoli Theorem.
Main statement. It's good to know it.
K compact. I won't drop this so that we can do it sometimes. Fn belongs to C of K. And what I mentioned, I should mention this kind of. Just call this. Even if I don't mention it, it's already obvious, right? Yeah. What is this property? Point wise bounded. Bounded. And equicontinuous. This. Fn. Uniformly bounded. And number two, if it has a uniformly convergent subsequence. Just look at it. So, it's uniformly bounded. This is kind of easy. How? points if the value is capital M1, M2, 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 M2. Take the maximum. Capital M. Everything that's an epsilon distance. Wait, I'm following. I'm just giving you the idea. The proof of one. Of one. So it is equicontinuous. Why? For all is fixed. It's epsilon greater than zero. Then there is this delta such that for all is in the capital space, for all is belonging to the metric space, what do we have?
And now after that we use this argument here to conclude if
is convergent for everything. How? Now, this is an open cover. Open cover. Now, can I change this certain bit small? I'll change a small bit. I'll change one thing. Any idea? What I'm going to do? Any idea? I want to change this. Small change. Minute change, then we'll track the sun. Track the
theorem.
Yes. It belongs to you. Is this an open cover?
It's dense.
Yeah. It's dense because so every point of x is arbitrarily closed for all x in k. Here something belongs to such that y belongs to g delta of x. So we should have called this case as something else, but just for simpleness, I am calling this the same exercise. But this is not the same exercise, okay. Well, let me call them same as just to give a confusion. The first part is the first.
Right.
So using our previous theorem, we just proved. We are going to say what we will. We have a sequence, subsequence of functions, f of a1, that converges uniformly to some function f, and belongs to this c of k. Who said this belongs to c of k? We can prove that this is a complementary space, so this will lie here. So we will prove, we will start it, and I think we're going to have a lot of time. So we will prove the unproved results. For we're not going to say uniform now. This f in I of x goes to some fx for all x in z. So there exists some capital N. This is nomenclature. F of N I and like as G I. Again?
Yes.
Just simplify notation. And if G I, handling of G I is there some equicontinuous. This is subsequence of the F, right? We are heavily using this equicontinuous and this property. Now take X and Y. No, we just take x. X belongs to k. Okay. X belongs to k. So, x belongs to b delta of some delta. There is a high delta. Here what we conclude is slightly rigorously. There is the same such that for r I j, for r I greater than m, if g I x minus g I z minus g z, all is g. If a equal to 0, no issue, we can write f, no, nothing will happen. This is less than excitement. So just see. So what do I want? G of n I, G of I. Yeah. Let's find G. x minus dj of zi plus dj of zi minus g of zi. So again, we try to equal. This is less than epsilon by our argument b delta. The distance less than delta here, so the this total distance is less than epsilon, and this is also less than epsilon. So the total stress is less than 2 epsilon, and the epsilon is arbitrary. We can make it as small as possible. So this x was arbitrary in the first place. So the sequence which we got constructed, g of epsilon, g of I. What is g of I? Every this convergence is for every x belonging to this category. So we have got a subsequence that converges uniformly. So we are done actually. The Arzelà-Ascoli theorem is proved. So the next part, since there's a lot of time, we assumed a lot of results. We can prove one by one some of them. Let's say, yeah.
So what actually we did is like take the subsequence of affine which will converge. And then prove that it converges for all x present in.
Yeah, since it's compact, we can use a lot of properties. The separability.
Yeah, we use that.
You can't use diagonal, you cannot enumerate anything arbitrarily. So you need a countable subset to enumerate.
Okay, sir. Huh. Before starting the proofs, take a break or something. Small break.
Yeah, second break.
Yes, 5 minutes.
Yeah, just wait for the reaction to come back, then I can try properly. Now we can't see anything. So you can ask any questions. Any doubts, any questions, any answers. Any questions, anyone? Okay. Now if you pick up some loose threads which is left during our talk. Okay. Now, see that. K, comma, D is compact. Is it readable from this?
Yes.
Compact. Fn is a subset belongs to the set C of K. Then uniform convergence implies equicontinuity. In the theorem, we assume the proof. Let's try to prove this. Yeah. Choose an epsilon greater than 0. Now, if Fn goes to uniform case for all n greater than n, there is a sum. Find a delta such that for all I equals to 1 to n, x minus y is the delta,
implies if I x minus if I y less than epsilon. Mind you, this delta is not independent of the n. But why do we write this? Because just see here, it's a finite number. You can delta 1, delta 2 and take the mean of the delta. Tenth delta. So this delta works for one question. Now what are we going to do for after greater than delta?
Compact. some is a very fancy word, but the sequentially compact moves. Nothing. That's the Bolzano Weirstrass property.
You want
Bolzano Weirstrass property?
Read that carefully. Something easy.
Sequentially.
No. Read the entire sentence.
It's compact.
It's compact.
Yeah, thanks. Sequentially compact is nothing much. Every sequence has converged to subsequence. The Bolzano is a property. Here, not a theorem. It becomes theorem when we assume compact. This is a legal matter. Bolzano is a property and compactness. This holds for any metric space, not R. Maybe anything. You cook up a metric space, give me a distance function, and this will go. Now, we are going to prove one direction. Suppose it is compact. Compact. We want to prove Bolzano Weirstrass property. And I will make this. Hope it's clear. So, take this thing. If it does not hold, prove by condensation. Prove by condensation. Xm is a sequence in E compact that has no convergent subsequence. So what the first thing to say about Xm? Can it have finite number of terms? No. Because then we have a constant subsequence. Something will be in some number of terms. Okay. Now, from this Xm, take an Xi. Xi is a point here. I say we can construct a border on it that contains no other part of Xm. Clear? If not, we will be point. If it is for every ball, something else lies here. Then that's the limit point rule.
Okay, sure.
Everything constant is zero. So take that ball. B of delta I, xi. This is the ball. And take the x of the step. Just aside. X is just a step. Now look here. Now what can you say? Is it open or closed?
It's
trivially closed. But to be closed, you have to limit point. There is no limit point at all. It must be closed. So we have a result. A closed subset of a compact set is compact. That's a one-dimensional. Closed subset of a compact set is compact. So one-way proof is that. This is one digression. P is compact. Give a closed subset. So B combinator is open. Close. Take an open cover BRLC. Open cover. Cover of B. Now this open cover of BR union with B combinator. This is an open cover of the entire thing. This is the finite sub cover. If this one lies in the finite sub cover, remove it. The rest of it is finite cover of V. So this is a digression. It's easy proof, so I just wanted to speak it up. So by the compactness of XR, compact, this is closed, implies cover. Why is closed? Closed because no limit points. Take the union of this delta I xi. Yeah. One thing is, what do you mean? Open cover. This is the final sub cover. J equals to 1 to n, b
delta ij, I sub ij, x I j, volume notation. Yeah, done. There are a lot of points, each of these points does not intersect any other thing. And this says that any other xi lies in one of these balls, contradiction.
Yeah.
But this power cannot cover because of this criteria. Does not contain xj, xj for j not equals to 1. And this says this power contradiction.
What did we define there? V delta ij.
V delta ij. Good, okay. Come on, just subsequence. Delta I. How is
okay, so
delta I subsequence of I? There's a notation for subsequence. So, every compact set satisfies Bolzano Weirstrass property. So, we're done with this. Now, what about the converse? Now, E satisfies Bolzano Weirstrass property. You want to prove? Required to prove? Please come back. Now, first, look at a few things. We say, first take an open power. U alpha. Alpha belongs to some index at A. Yeah. We don't care about the index at A. Just a set. Maybe if we just have a clear, we never set it down the root control. Open power. It is contained in this. We want to say that this key can be covered by finite epsilon. How do we do that? Take x1 belonging to U1. First, it's an epsilon. The epsilon of x1 is in the box. So it's okay. Now take x2 belonging to E minus V epsilon 1 x1. Same thing, x3 belongs to E minus union of I equal to 1 to 2 V no, epsilon, it's epsilon, for all epsilon, okay. V epsilon, epsilon. Similarly, you pick x n plus 1 from this. Now look at x1, x2, xn. Excel, this sequence. What shall I say about this?
It's converging to some point in B.
Yeah, that's by definition of Bolzano Weirstrass. But what will you say from here?
Yeah.
Everything has at least epsilon away from everything else.
Yeah.
So how can it converge? It cannot converge. Every Cauchy sequence is converged in a convex way. But every convergence sequence is always Cauchy, whether it's convex or not. We take x, x1 here, x current distance. Whatever you pick is outside this. So whatever you pick next is outside this. Here this. Go
ahead. It's not possible, but it converges, so it's
possible. Yeah. Cannot have a convergence of sequence. Contradicting. The Bolzano Weirstrass property. So this can be covered by open balls. That's it. Now, let us next thing we want to show that we can find one R where x is an R greater than 0. Step 2. R greater than 0 such that
every x in this range. The volume containing mu of alpha or something. Now look at this. If we have proved this, then our experiment is done, right? We had a counter alpha ball of open ball. Yeah, you see, RSC, one wants to get an R. We take all the open balls of the radius R, take all the corresponding alpha in which is contained. So this minus half power is contained in some other minus half power. And this still Q alpha was arbitrary. We got this alpha minus half power of the radius of any open power. So we will be done. So the main thing is to prove this. So again, our old friend proved by contradiction. When we have nothing else to do, nothing better, we do prove by contradiction. This goes to something belonging free. The Bolzano Weirstrass property is the full thing. It is converted to something in that set. That is the Bolzano Weirstrass property. So this must be this set must be contained in some other property, some set. Some alpha such that they belong to you alpha. It was just a point, and they were dealing with the sequence. But the same reason. So now this. Why? Because that is the graphical is nice actually. Z is ZK. The distance between this is less than epsilon by 2. And if you want the distance to be less than epsilon by 2, yeah. This is there. This is there and this is epsilon. If we want ZK to be sufficiently close to there, any less than epsilon by 2, okay. This is less than epsilon by 2. So this bound is smaller than the boundary. Okay. So we fit a ball inside this and for all k greater than this k. True for all. So after a certain point of time, all these data lines will lie within this new alpha.
sense? Is 1 by n less than epsilon by 2? Or large enough? Or large enough? Even? Can we have 1 and here we have another n? Take the maximum? Call it n. So, calling n 1 and n, what do we think? That's what we do in analysis. So, from here, ball of 1 by 2 of xn. So, what do we say? This is containing u of alpha. So, this contradicts our assumption. Yeah. It works for all greater than that. So, this is true. This is true. And once we have this, our theorem is correct. Constant balls around each point. We have a finite subcomponent of balls that's over the set. And each of these balls is contained in one of the u alphas. So, the corresponding u alphas over the set. So, we are done. It's compact. Sequentially compact implies compact. So this is the most general version, may not be the most, for Minkowski spaces, it is the most general version of the Bolzano Weirstrass property, which you till now have seen the real life. Now, here's another interesting question. A lot of questions can be asked when you want to use the set of functions under the uniform norm. So that's not the only norm. Suppose it, just for example, suppose it R, you have Euclidean distance, right? I'm just emphasizing that the norm may not be unique. Infinitely very different norms. X1 to Xn, Y1 to Y1. Take a diagonal matrix, alpha 1, alpha n. X1 to Xn, Y1 to Y1. All these alpha i's are strictly positive. Then this function, this is the function of x and y, this is the perfect norm. So go to the next step. If this is not a diagonal, but a diagonalizable matrix, the same thing works. I don't know whether you want the diagonalizable properties, so I won't go much into it. And even when you are studying the matrix space and variable functions, there also you can define another major from one another thing. And another interesting property, the sequence of functions, you are talking about functions on a compact space, those are continuous. Is that, and you say, is the space of functions separable? Yeah, it must be separable, it's compact. So it must be separable. Now, there's another theorem. Bit different. I'm not going to speak out the theorem, I'll just speak it out. We can't always work with arbitrary functions. How do we define cause and sign? In school life, when we were little kids, what we learned? The perpendicular or the hypotenuse, that's the sine function. Now, when we're doing actual mathematics, you don't go about drawing triangles. You have to deal with this somehow. So, how do you define the sine function? Yeah, it's the power series. Ultimately, the best functions you can work with are the polynomials and the expression of the polynomials, the power series and the rational functions. Even the rational functions you can express it by some bigger formula. And when it converges or when it does not, that's the big thing. So, the best functions are the polynomials. Everyone must agree on that. If you don't agree, after 1 year, you will see that, yeah, polynomials are the best thing. So, there's a short question theorem. Every continuous function, you can approximate it by polynomials. Not only polynomials, it's a more general version. If a particular function satisfies certain properties, we can approximate anything by that. There is something called Fourier transforms, Fourier function. Any periodic function can be written as some linear combinations of the sine, cos. If it is a complex term, it's e power I theta. E power I theta when theta runs from 0 to 2 pi, that gives you 0 to 2 pi. And you just scale it. Any period in the product is 0 to 2 pi. Whatever period you want. And that's what gives the I You have a square wave.
Yes.
Square wave. And the sawtooth wave. Then the energy that comes here is by sums of sines and cosines. So how can we do that? And the basis is that the stone Mr. theorem. This applies here. Everything is approximate by this. That's the countable then subset. Polynomial, that's countable, right? The set of polynomials is countable. That forms a jth subset in the space of functions. So, we'll learn about this later.
Why is the polynomial
sound? Why is the polynomial sound? Okay. Oh, sorry, polynomials with rational coefficients.
Yeah.
If you take real coefficients, then you have no more. The monomials are uncountable. Take just one constant polynomial, they are uncountable. Integer coefficients are rational. Yeah. So, I think if you have any more questions, you can ask.
There are polynomials from the open length subset, so we can limit them to any function we want to give it. Like we can get arbitrary flows using the polynomials of our series to any function we want, any continuous function.
Yeah, that's another theorem. This won't equal this. That is a stronger theorem, Stone Weirstrass theorem. Once you prove the Weirstrass theorem using on the real line, the Stone Weirstrass theorem is far more general. So that would take another 2 hours. Yeah, yeah, that's how we prove the real thing. But we can prove for any general family of functions. For example, I say how to do the Fourier one. Yeah, for that is the general, and those are not the only things. Once the family of functions satisfies a certain property, you can use this to approximate any one person. So, any other questions? So I think that's what I have to say.